Assalamu alaikum. You're watching Views and News, and I'm Faisal Rahman, live from our Islamabad studio. Today, we'll be talking about the role of the world powers in curbing terrorism. There are a couple of very interesting facts. If you look at the year 2002-2003 and onwards till 2014, this is what the data which I have at the moment with me. The Americans, they have spent over $6 trillion, T for trillion, $6 trillion. And if you just talk about the Middle East, the terrorism factor has increased by 4,500%. Now, that is after spending that kind of money. So this is something which I failed to understand why it happened. That is going to be the main topic of discussion. Prior to 9/11, there was just one bomb blast, a suicidal bomb blast in Pakistan. But after that, till 2014, more than 1,950 bomb blasts were recorded. Before the Iraqi invasion, there was not even a single suicidal bomb blast that took place in Iraq. But we all know what happened after that. I think, according to certain people, almost equivalent to the size of the ammunition that was used in the Second World War that was used in Iraq. Every weapon was tested and tried out there. We all know what happened in Afghanistan. We are seeing what's happening in Syria. We saw regime changes in Egypt. We saw regime changes in Libya, and what happened to Muammar Gaddafi or Hosni Mubarak for that matter, or Algeria. And then calm down. Nothing happened in Saudi Arabia. Things got out of hands once in Bahrain, but they took charge and they controlled and they sent their own forces. Look what is happening in Yemen. Every other day there's a bomb blast, there is killing. So everybody was thinking that something is going on in the Muslim countries primarily, and people used to blame this is because of the Americans. All right, sir, we have four lines. They were all exposed, explored. Shias were killing the Sunnis were killing the Shias, and then various other ethnic groups were fighting amongst each other. But recent wave of violence that started in Europe, let's talk about Turkey. What a beautiful country. That was an example for the entire world. Look at their economy, look at the GDP, the way they took off like this. Bomb blast in Ankara, bomb blast in the other city, then certain factions were blamed for that. Then suddenly we heard that Daesh attacked certain areas in Jordan yesterday. Four security personnel were killed. All right, sir. And then we talk about certain mosques that were attacked in Saudi Arabia a few months ago. Again, another problem. Then you look at the factors involved. The killing of the Russian envoy in Ankara. That was a story and a half. Who was shot dead by a policeman who was very young and who was hardly 23, 24 years old. But he ended up killing him. Then you look at what happened in Germany. Early to that, if you remember what happened in Nice and in France, and you talk about what happened in Switzerland. Now, you don't need to have a bomb to kill 12, 13, 14 or maybe 50 people. All you need is a bus or a truck and just run over them. That is the new technique that is being used. So what I'm saying is that at the end of the day, despite whatever is happening, post 9/11 in particular, there is an absolute unrest. I'm not talking about the African countries, and so far I haven't talked about the Far Eastern countries, but there's a lot going on there as well. We talk about Malaysia, we talk about Indonesia, we talk about Thailand for that matter. A lot of groups. Then this new phenomenon of Islamophobia, that emerged. What exactly is that supposed to mean? Then there is Daesh, there is IS, there is ISIL, there is Boko Haram. There are so many non-state actors. God knows where they have come from, but the one thing which is common, that they're all, unfortunately, Muslims. Are they actually Muslims, or who is supporting them? Who is financing them? Who is aiding them? Somebody is providing them weapons, somebody is providing them some training. And who are these people, by the way? I'm sure there has to be a series of programs on this particular topic, but we'll try to engage our panelists in a way that we could get as much out from them as possible. But counter strategy regarding terrorism, that has totally failed. Look at the number of people that were killed in Pakistan post 9/11. That's well over 70,000. Forget about the economic factor. I'm talking about human lives. Certain footages which we see and we can't show you on TV, trust me, you won't be able to have a look even for a second. This is what is happening in the world. And the media is showing a certain side. You put on one television channel, they have a certain narrative. You put on another television channel, there's another story altogether. To talk about this, we have with us owner, right? As Ambassador Aslam. Rizvi Saab needs to introduce the senior diplomat, sir. Thank you very much, sir. We have with us General Masood Saab, again, needs no introduction, is very senior analyst, sir. Thank you very much. And we have with us Dr. Nazir Hussain Saab. Thank you very much, sir, for taking out your time. Rizvi Saab, there are so many questions, obviously, which are popping up in my mind at the moment. But whatever is happening, can you answer why is it happening?
Well, that's a very complex answer for that, but I think it's easy to identify various backgrounds to this. There are political assassinations. Let's start with the one which set off the First World War, for example. Then we see the in more recent times, and I think the I would place the issue of Palestine as the starting point of where the world is today and the reaction of the Israelis on that. We saw the first so-called terrorist attack took place in the Olympic team.
The Israeli attack
from there, and the Israeli policy of you know, hitting back hard and state terrorism against what they looked at as the terrorist. The reality is that the freedom struggle, the right for right of self-determination, for right of statehood, has been over the years changed into that new narrative of terrorism. We see that here in the area in Kashmir, and this applies to many other parts of the world. So that is this fact. The second, of course, is a traditional sectarian violence, which has been going on for years and centuries. So, accentuated by factors outside, through the support of non-Muslims in particular, in some cases Muslims as well. In more recent times, you just mentioned the fact that after 9/11, what has happened in Pakistan, what has happened in Middle East, be it Libya, Algeria, Tunisia, Egypt, Syria, Iraq, and then closer home, Afghanistan, is because of the intervention of the United States and the Western allies. Meddling in these countries, their political setup, on the
their effort to bring in democracy.
Democracy. And instead of democracy, we see chaos and birth of terrorism, the birth of suicide attacks and so on. Because once you deny the people the right, political rights to govern and live in their own manner, and you try and impose something from outside, they have nothing, no other option when you come and kill their families. You deny them their religious rights and so on. Then they have to resort to militant ways of countering outside interference.
That is retaliation.
That is the retaliation that we see that has happened here. And you see another example here, for example, next door, we saw that what happened to the Sikhs and the price paid by Indira Gandhi for attacking the Gurdwara. So, you know.
And then the son, Rajiv Gandhi.
Rajiv Gandhi.
Again, their involvement in Sri Lanka.
So many of these cases, you know, you will find when you ask this question, it's a combination of many, many factors. They are religious, they are political, they are ethnic. You know, they are the imposition of outside values on, you know, on countries and people, and denial of their right of fundamental rights, and on the pretext of protecting their human rights and humanitarian rights. I mean, we saw the intervention of the West in Libya humanitarian grounds, on protecting the human rights, and look where the country is right now.
Exactly, so, and look what has happened to Syria. We talk about Aleppo. Just take the example that once it was the industrial hub, It was the financial hub. It was the cultural hub. And right now, if you look at those visuals, it's totally ruined. That is all you see, destroyed buildings, and that's it.
Earlier you saw, of course, Beirut.
And maybe that is by design.
Earlier you saw Beirut. I mean, exactly the same thing. I mean, that was the...
Beirut was the hub, sir. If you were supposed to travel to Europe or anywhere else, I mean, Beirut was the main point. It wasn't Dubai or Qatar for that matter. Yes. So, obviously, Jalsab, I do understand you never believe in conspiracies. You're a very practical man. But, sir, in certain cases, do you think there are certain factors that are involved? There are certain minds that are playing the larger game? And which we are unable to maybe read or understand. Do you think so, sir?
Well, I mean, you can call it conspiracy or you can call it a deliberate plan.
Yeah.
And those also are in play. Well, obviously, you know, the very fact that, I mean, for instance, I think we have to trace back a little earlier as to how, you know, the things have been moving in the direction of sort of destroying this infrastructure, political infrastructure, and also the whole social structure and the cultural structure, and also building up militancy in the minds of them, especially the Muslims of Afghanistan and Pakistan and so on. Let's start, I think, although you have already given a very broad overview, and so has Ambassador Aslam, but I would say that let's start and take think that the starting point is the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan, as far as we are concerned. Right. I think that would be more relevant in the context of Pakistan. And then we can build up from there, although there is also a previous history to that. When the Soviets occupied Afghanistan, we could have stayed back. There, I mean, it's still a debate, but it's irrelevant at the moment. We fully participated with the Americans in order to push back the Soviets from Afghanistan. In that, we did build up our own jihadi elements, not knowing that what sort of effect it would have on our society.
We are creating, yeah? Yes.
It would have a blowback on our society. So we didn't realize that, because we never think in long term or even in medium term. We only see the short-term gains. And of course, General Zia also had to sort of legitimize himself. And for that purpose, he thought this was a great opportunity for him to legitimize and to also project Islam and the spread of Islam and so on and so forth. I'll try to make it brief, because there are many points that you have covered.
But Jalsab, if you allow me, you were serving and you were very close to Ziaulak at that time. Is it true that initially, Pakistan was fighting that war and supporting the jihadi element on its own, and after about a year and a half, or maybe a little more than that, then the American intervention was there. Is it correct, sir?
Well, we had probably decided,
And what was your appointment, sir, at that time?
I was the chairman of Pakistan Ordnance Factories Board at that time. And my view is, I was not in the policy making per se, but I was in a sufficiently senior rank to understand what was going on. My view is that there were two factors. One was that General Zia was trying to legitimize himself, and he thought this was a great opportunity for him to legitimize himself and to get onto the right side of the Americans and the Western world, because he was an international pariah when he hung Bhutto. So that was a terrible thing that he had done. So he had to sort of legitimize himself and get respected. So he thought this was a great one. But at the same time, I think his ideological orientation was also such that it really converged with the circumstances and helped him. At that time. So that was one mistake. Then followed by that, I think when 9/11 took place, that was again a disaster. There are people, and still, we are still undecided as to truly the jury is still out as to whether we should have participated in the 9/11, in the way that we did wholeheartedly. As a non-NATO ally. Mm. And then it had its consequences. It had very adverse consequences. Then obviously, everyone knows about it. We have repeated that several times, so I'll go a little further. Then what happens is that as far as the world powers are concerned, they are interested in preserving Israel. And they think that there are two things which bother them. One is they say that, well, so long as these dictators are there, you know, whether it is the dictator Assad in Syria or Saddam Hussein in Iraq and so on, we will never be able to sort of have peace in the Middle East, and especially for Israel. We cannot give it the protection that we need to give to Israel.
But Saddam Hussein was their own
that
man.
That was, well, I
they
mean,
deployed him. I mean,
he may have been his own man, but you know, they also see the future as to exactly how. So they wanted to ensure that Israel really becomes a state which is viable, which can resist all the forces which are opposing it. So what happens is that they really try to sort of undermine all the regimes, in fact, from one after the other in the Middle East. And they did undermine, and then they didn't either deliberately didn't think through the point that you were making, okay, whether it was a conspiracy, or whether they thought that having you know, thrown all the regimes out in such disarray, they thought something really democratic or something like that would emerge. Naturally, it would not. There was such a huge vacuum, especially the way that they went about in Iraq, for instance, that they also completely destroyed the military in Iraq. And so all the most of the military then became a part of, whether you call it Al-Qaeda or Daesh or whatever you want to give any name for that. So the what has happened is similarly, all over the Middle East, things like that has happened. And today, none of the regimes are really in control of their area.
That's
most
great.
Of these countries, whether it Iraq is divided in three parts, Syria is divided in about five parts at the moment. And so that you can say that, well, they have been able to achieve in a way in that
they've diluted the powers.
They have created monsters all over.
And in these order to monsters, protect Israel, I mean, Israel.
They may have protected Israel, but they've created monsters which are all over the world. And, you know, today, I mean, yesterday or day before, you know, the Berlin incident took place. Similarly, so many incidents are taking place. Look at the incident in France and all that.
A very similar incident.
So what has happened is that they have tried to protect, you know, Israel, but in the process, they have destroyed. And then I will also not stop here. Before I end, I would like to also say that the Muslim countries are also equally responsible, because they were not democratic, they were not representing the will of the people, they were staying in power by getting the support of either the West or the Soviet Union or Russia, and this is how, you know, they continue to sort of rule, and even today most of them are like that. So unless they have the will and the support of the people behind them, they will continue to depend on either the West or the other major powers. And that would sort of limit their independence in terms of policy.
And even now, I mean, if you look at the latest development, Dr. Saab, the Russian foreign minister, the Turkish foreign minister, and the Iranian foreign minister, they did not even consult the United Nations or the Americans. And the Americans were really not actually happy. Neither the Syrian regime. And they were talking about it. And there was a time the Turkish, they had a very strong stance against the regime. But now they're not using that kind of a hard tone for them. So it seems that new military alliances or new political alliances are forming in certain parts of the world. And that is where the shift is taking place. Jordan might get involved. And as I would, because Pakistan do not recognize, we do not recognize Israel as a state. And that is written on a passport stamped. We even can go to South Africa, but we can't go to Israel because people believe that it's an illegitimate occupation of the state of Palestine. Israel is not a country. Sir?
There are multiple factors. I would not repeat what my two senior colleagues have mentioned. But before answering this very pertinent question, let's start in the 1980s, as General Saab has very well mentioned, the introduction of the non-state actors into global politics. It was by design, I must say, starting from Al-Qaeda and Taliban in our vicinity, And then second most important element emerged was the proxies, the use of these very non-state actors as proxies by all and sundry, the global powers, the regional powers, everyone. Even I would not say that even Israel used these very proxies in that. And the third factor, which both of my senior colleagues mentioned, the destruction of the political structure in Middle East that destroyed the whatever the regimes were doing. And I must quote Ms. Condoleezza Rice, the Secretary of State of the United States of America. She wrote in an article that for long 60 years, we were promoting dictators to get stability. And at the end, we neither got the democracy or not the stability. So this is the end result.
And those who were there for four decades were eventually eliminated.
And this is the result that today the global politics is in flux because of the new emerging alliances. And as you mentioned yourself, Russia is in a new power, global power emerging after resurgence, both in Europe and now in Middle East. Look at China.
Crimea, Ukraine, and now in Syria.
Now look at China. China surpassing Japan, China surpassing Germany, now challenging the United States of America.
Yes.
So in this context, and then most importantly, let's see after 9/11, whether it was a conspiracy, whether it was a plan, but one sentence which I like the most, it was license to kill given by these non-state actors to the United States of America. And you mentioned the figures. In that particular incident, only 4,000, okay, that was very important, 4,000 people were killed. But let's see the global terrorism.
Talking about 9/11?
Yeah.
Less than 3,000, sir.
Less than 3,000. Let's see the global terrorism portal. More than 1 million people have been killed at the name of counterterrorism. So if state terrorism is promoted to undermine terrorism, that is again promotion of state terrorism, promotion of terrorism. So it will not end because you are using the non-state actor, you are using the proxies, I'm naming all. And then you are destroying the very structure on which those very regimes were based.
I still remember there were statements that the Americans and the West in particular, France and even Britain, they were supporting the so-called rebels in, these are the rebels now, whatever you call them. These rebels, I mean, now they're being defeated. Aleppo is pretty much clear. And then we suddenly hear that. So just imagine, I mean, there was a very interesting article that the rebels have got Humvees worth about $1 billion. How come they have the best of the best weapons, sir?
Exactly. And second most important factor is, as General Sir might be agreeing with me, once Henry Kissinger mentioned, vis-a-vis Middle East was concerned, that there can be no war in Middle East without the participation of Egypt. And we saw that after 1979, there was no major war between the Arabs and Israel. And there can be no peace in the Middle East without the participation of Syria. Syria is the linchpin of stability in the entire Middle East.
And why is that so?
It is because of factor that it links the Arab vis-a-vis the non-Arab, that is Persia, that is Iran. So why Iran is investing so much in Syria? Although it's not a regime, a theocratic regime, it's not even, sorry to say, it is a pure secular regime, Ba'athist regime. But Iran is supporting us by tooth and nail and saying that, okay, we will cause this.
The Alawites.
As you mentioned, it is Russia, it is Iran, and it is Bashar al-Assad, which is deciding the destiny of the entire Middle East and Syria. So Syria is going to be the linchpin. It is the linchpin. And therefore, the entire structure of Middle East and terrorism would be based on this. And I have written on ISIS, who funded this, who has created this, who has named this. There's a one clip of Miss Hillary Clinton while she was giving a testimony in the Congress. Everyone knows that.
Yes.
Mr. Putin himself, when he was delivering a speech in the UN General Assembly, and in the, later on, he is a one-man clip, and he has named the countries who are supporting the IS. One most important factor, lastly, the IS can reach to Germany, they can reach to Australia, they were not reaching to Israel, which is just next door, if they are so Islamic. This man, very particular man who killed the Russian ambassador, he says, I have avenged the slaughter of Aleppo. Good enough. But have you ever avenged the slaughter of the Hamas and the Palestinians?
These Russians, they have sent a delegation, I think a 20-member delegation, to investigate this incident.
Exactly.
Because a lot of people believe that why wasn't this man captured alive? Why was he killed? I mean, it's just like the story of JFK, for that matter, or Abraham Lincoln, you know. And it's pretty interesting. Now, moving on to you, sir. Let's talk about Pakistan, because this is where our concern is. We did support and create, and the narrative was built, Haqqaniya and the Haqqani network and Mujahideen. This element came in, and there was this cause to fight the Soviet Union. Primarily, the idea was because we were the members of CENTO and CETO, we were always had a tilt towards the Americans and the West in particular. And we never had a great relationship with the Russians. The Indians did capitalize even in that era. Now, we want them to come here and invest. At that time, they wanted to do the same, but we said, no, sir, you're not supposed to. Because otherwise, things would have been very different. Looking at what is the current situation in Afghanistan, sir, it seems as if there is a war of intelligence agencies, whether it's RAW, whether it's CIA, whether it's NDC, or whether it's ISI, because your first line of defense is your intelligence agency, so you can't rule that factor out. And then you've got multiple other intelligence agencies. This is exactly what is happening in Syria, what is happening in Afghanistan at the moment. Certain factions are supporting certain ideologies, certain are supporting some other. That creates a lot of confusion. And so the decision-making process becomes so difficult that we're not able to achieve any desired output, sir. Is it correct?
Well, after the end of the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, when you had all these Mujahideens, the war was over, and here you had highly trained and highly militant groups were there. And they were imbibed with a spirit that on the name of Islam, they could conquer anything, could do, because after all, they did beat and defeat a superpower, brought it to its knees. And we saw that the Arabs, as well as the Afghans and the Pakistanis, they decided then to start feeling important enough, and we started utilizing them in Kashmir. We saw many of these Arabs went back to their own countries. They started movements there. So the we had this.
And few became the members of those particular groups. They started proxies in Pakistan, Shia versus Sunni, in Parachinar, Karachi, you name it, in Pakistan.
Exactly. So this is how it started in this region from here. Now the factor remains that as we have seen that when the war ended, and then we saw post 9/11, we had the Afghans, the Taliban coming and taking refuge in Pakistan. We had the NATO forces, a huge amount of forces trying to get rid of Al-Qaeda, trying to sort out
everyone. Amongst the top countries, UAE, Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, to recognize the government of the Taliban.
So they hopelessly failed to stop the so-called militants from there. And we saw that the one faction of that, the Haqqani network, been given refuge in Pakistan. And the West, led by the Americans, blame Pakistan all along, that because they have taken refuge in Pakistan, therefore they were not able to eliminate them and bring about the democracy that they wanted to introduce in Afghanistan, bring around stability. Now, the Pakistan, since we started Zarbe Arts, we have been able to clear the areas in Fatah and North Waziristan, and we've got rid of all the terrorist activity from there. They have moved away. But then some of them have dispersed within the country as well. And we saw that, reaction coming from there. From Pakistan side, the Pakistan Taliban, who have been attacking us, they have gone across to Afghanistan and taken refuge there, you know, Fazlullah. So the point is that there is a still a need.
Sir, need. I'll just have to take a short break here. A quick short break. We'll just return and start from there. We'll take a break here and we'll continue our discussion after that. Welcome back after the break. Sir.
You see, what has happened is that Pakistan has been now described as a heaven for terrorists and so on, and neighbors of the world. And that is because we are not taking action against the Haqqani network, foreign secretaries have come out in an open statement that we must take action. We should not differentiate between good Taliban and bad Taliban if you have to tackle this problem. More also importantly, we are getting bad names because of the proscribed...
But if they are not a threat to Pakistan, why should we go after them? Just because under the American pressure, sir?
Not the American pressure, because you cannot. What are we gaining out of them from here? I mean, our neighbors, Afghanistan, is claiming that their leadership is sitting here. You may have cleared the areas from there, and you know, the stability and security of Afghanistan is directly related to Pakistan as well. So it is important that we should try, and you know, the tag that is being put on Pakistan, we should put our house in order.
All right.
The proscribed organizations which are there, they are meeting around, they're going around, you know, who are, take for example, the Samiullahs, Maulana Samiullahs from there. His madrasa, who's known to be a jihadist, being provided 300 million kind of rupees by the KPK government from here. We see other from here, the RR. The Quetta attack from there, the madrasas from there. So we have to freeze we have to tackle two ways: the sources of their financing, and number two.
Then sir, there we go. Reform, we have this national action plan,
but reform of the madrasas, and you know we need to act on the action plan if we have to get away from this terrorism within Pakistan.
All right, Jalsab, 9/11, post 9/11, the beginning of this century, sir, of this 21st century. Do you think the New World Order, there was something like New World Order, sir, which existed, and there was some mastermind planning it and executing it, sir?
Well, I don't think any individual can sort of determine how the world evolves itself, you know. I think there are several forces which are at work in different countries and also in different continents. And I think it is these forces which eventually bring about certain changes. And there are changes in different segments or different institutional levels. I would say that, for instance, let's take the political side. As far as politics is concerned, generally speaking, as far as democratic evolution is concerned, we have always looked up to America and to the European world, especially the Western Europe. But even there has been so many changes. And the way, for instance, the election of President-elect Trump by itself is a new phenomena. So the world is undergoing a great change, is in a state of flux. And what are those stimuli which are bringing about this change? I think one is, of course, the influence of the media.
A lot of rightist governments are in power, whether you talk about the West or Europe in particular, sir.
So I think that phenomena is, I think, linked to the economy, the way that the economy has only sort of, although the economy of most of these Western countries, including America, did continue to sort of show progress, especially that of America, but it only benefited a very small
community
percentage at the top. And the middle class and the lower middle class did not get the benefits of the improvement in the economy. And in fact, some of them even got were worse off than what they were 10 years ago or 15 years ago. So I think that phenomena also did help in bringing about Trump, you know, into power. But your question was very, it was a broad sweep. I think we can discuss it next time. Because
there are a lot of people do believe that 9/11 was an inside job. For various reasons, for various accounts, certain footages were removed, certain were just put in there, and those buildings, I mean, and the number of people who were present there, and the objectives they achieved right after that. How would we never heard of Al-Qaeda before that? Right away, holding a book which was upside down,
I think
Mr. Bush comes up with this idea. Well, that was Osama bin Laden who's hiding in Afghanistan. Let's attack that guy.
You know, the thing is that you can't hide these secrets. I mean,
the way those buildings fell, I mean, sir, there are like so many whistleblowers all over the world. I mean, talking about it.
It would be outrageous for us to promote, you know, this sort of thinking, which has been prevalent in certain circles.
But do you think it is also wise to rule out those factors, sir?
Well, I mean, those factors have been dealt with.
Building 7, the way it fell.
No, I think...
I mean, it was like a mile away from where the...
But, you know, it sounds so ridiculous that somebody should, you know, a country, a government, should really kill its own people.
For a larger objective.
Yeah, for goodness sake. I mean, have a heart. What is the larger objective? The larger objective can be achieved without killing 3,000 people. So I think we are sadly mistaken if we continue to think on those lines.
Well, that is one school of thought.
I know.
More than that, I think it's the neocons who came into power. And the first start of the real, post 9/11, was the attack on Iraq. That was the real turning point.
Where are those weapons of mass destruction? Colin Powell was the Secretary of State at that time, and he was like, well, these are the weapons, these are the trucks, these are the scuds and everything. And eventually that particular man even left that party.
Yeah. No, the point there was that Bush wanted that his father's mission should be completed and Saddam Hussein should be removed. And I think he just planted the story.
All right. So that's what I'm saying. I mean, that they were never there. If they were there, he might have used this. So one excess of evil at that time, Roxa, look what happened to Germany post the Second World War. They got squeezed in Wall of Berlin, Hitler gone, all the generals gone. What happened to Mussolini? We all know. The second country, Italy. What happened to Japan? Nobody ever made a movie on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We do talk about Pearl Harbor all the time. And then we all know that Japan was literally flattened. Excess of evil this time were some other countries. Now the point is, in the future, there could be any other alliance of excess of evil, sir?
There are alliances. I mean, you know, every war, global war, produces two things. New global political order and new global economic order. You were just mentioning, asking General Saab, that was 9/11 opened a new global world order? Yes. Theoretically, it was Huntington and Fukuyama which penetrated the entire mindset of the think tanks in around the United States of America and the global world, where it was being penetrated as a trump of the global power of the United States of America. The liberal democracy has won, communism is no more there, we have a new order. In 1991, when Saddam was defeated in the Kuwait crisis, it was announced that George Bush Sr. announced this. I remember the date, May 1 or May 2, 1991, a new world order has been created. And that new world order, as Ambassador Aslam was saying, was what? The supremacy of the neocons in the United States of America. That was in reaction that certain other power centers came into being. And that power center was, again, Russia. I mean, today, you call upon that United States of America is a global hyperpower, but you cannot decide anything without the participation of Russia anymore. It is Syria. It was Syria. It was Europe. It is Europe. It is Asia. It is Asia. So it All is right. The new world order is emerging. And this time around, last word, the new world order would be based in Asia, is based in Asia. It is China, in economic terms? Is it Russia in political and military terms? And it is a regional power. You may include Iran, you may not include Iran, but who is in fact calling the shots? And lastly, Trump is mostly relying on Mr. Putin.
So, well, they want to be the best buddies. Let's see what happens after that. But anyway, Aslam, Rizvi Saab, thank you very much. It was a pleasure, sir. Thank you very much, Doc Saab. And that's all we have for this, sir. I'll see you tomorrow at 8. Till then, you take good care of yourself. Khuda hafiz.